going to talk about Phing. First, a little bit about myself. My name is Rick. You can find me on Twitter at RS Kuipers. I'm from Apeldoorn, so it's about an hour away. Who was that? Awesome. All right. I work at the Webman. It's a company who mostly works with Magento and Zend Framework. So I'm afraid to say that I'm a little bit of a Magento developer. Don't hit me. Don't throw tomatoes.
Me too.
But I also do Zend Framework.
We won't judge you.
Good,
too much.
Good.
But too much.
I also do Zend Framework, which I love, and I'm hoping to explore Symfony a little bit more, but see how that goes. So, what is Phing? Phing is a build tool. I can hear you think, why do we need a build tool? I mean, it's PHP, we're not compiling anything. You can use Phing to package everything. You can use Phing to execute your quality assurance tasks. So Phing is actually very useful, and I'm going to show you that throughout this presentation. You can install Phing through Pear or Composer. I would say Pear is probably still recommended, although they're making the transfer to Composer. But I found that installing through Composer is not foolproof. So I would still recommend going with Pear. I hope that changes in the near future. Can you see this, by the way?
Yeah.
All right. Good. So who here has used Phing before? That's good. All right.
At least it's something.
Is there anyone here that used Ant? Wow, OK, I'm surprised. That's cool. So Ant's been around for, I think, 6 years longer than Phing. Ant, I think, started in 2000. And Phing has been around since 2006. So there's one huge, humongous difference between Phing and Ant, and that is that Phing is PHP. It's built in PHP, so we all know that language. And Ant's built in Java, which not everyone knows. And you know, you have to install it on your computer if you want to run Ant. Also, there's a small difference between how it's installed. Phing is installed through Pear or Composer, and Apache Ant is installed through your package manager, which I don't know which one you prefer. I like Phing, though, hence this talk. But they have something in common, which is that they both use a build file, a build.xml file. And you'll notice that it's very similar. And if you put the documentation of Ant and the documentation of Phing next to each other, you'll see that they have a lot of common. And even if you can't find something in the Phing documentation, it's probably good to check out the Ant documentation, and maybe you'll find it in there. So what I'm going to be doing in this talk is I'm going to get ourselves started with the skeleton application of Zend Framework 2. And what we're going to do, this is actually the 2.0 one. In the Zend Framework tutorial, this is going to annoy me. People are tweeting me. There. this is actually the skeleton application from the tutorial from Zend Framework 2, and this is version 2.0. And that's the version that still has unit tests, because as some of you may know, version 2.1 and up, they don't put the unit tests in the tutorial anymore. So what I did was I followed the 2.0 tutorial. So this is a skeleton application, and as you can see, we have our two modules. We have the album module and the application module, and they both have their tests. So I hope everyone's a little bit familiar with Zend Framework and this setup over here. So first thing we're going to do to even get started is let's create our build file. Typically, I create the build.xml in my document root. And let's have a look what you can put in there. So you start off with the XML definition saying which version of XML you're using. And as a root tag, you have the project tag. You can give your project a name, which in this case is a ZF2. And you can give it a default target to execute. Take your time. I'll wait. You can give it a default target to execute. And as you can see, basically, a build file will exist, consist of one or more targets. And the targets is, they're pieces of logic that you want to be executing. So we have our build target over there that, in this case, is pretty empty. So let's have a look at the Phing executable. If you execute Phing with the minus L parameter or argument, you get a list of all the targets that are in your build file. And it even gives you a little warning there saying target build has no tasks or dependencies, meaning this file is as useless as it can be. And this is how you just execute your target. What you can also do if you want to execute a specific target is by giving that as a parameter. So if I were to say Phing build, it will only execute the build target. So I'm going to go through some of the fundamentals of Phing, namely properties, file sets, pattern sets, and tasks. So let's start up with properties. So properties are your PHP variables. I usually define all my directory, my whole directory structure in properties, so I can easily refer to them and change them. So you see here, the top one is a build dir, and it has a value, and you can see in the value it has a dollar bracket. That's actually a reference to an existing property. And in this case, project.basedir is a default property that every Phing file has. So basically, the project base there is by default the directory where your build.xml is in. So in this case, I'm probably just saying ./build. So there, I've got my build there property set up. And some others, namely the logs there, the cache there, and the source there, which we're all going to be using throughout this talk. I hope everyone understands how properties work. It's pretty similar to PHP variables. So we also got file sets, and file sets is just a collection of files. That's very useful because there are some talks that need a file set to execute their logic onto. So this is how you define a file set. As you can see, I gave the file set an ID, in this case php.files. I did that so I'm able to refer to it later on. So later on in the complete build.xml, you'll see that I have more than one reference to this file set. So, you know, don't repeat yourself. Inside the file set, you see that I have an include tag. What it does is I can give it a pattern, and it'll find files based on that pattern. So let's have a look and see what this actually finds. So assuming that we're executing this from that build.xml file you see at the top, can everyone read this, by the way? Is this clear? Also, the code itself, the color scheme. That's an excellent idea. It's right here, isn't it? Hey. Okay, I'm going to start over. No, just kidding. Is everything on? Oh, okay, it doesn't really matter. Okay, so yeah, we've got our file set. As you can see, I underlined the file that it matches. So in this case, it matches everything that ends with .php in the same folder. So in this case, that's example.php. So let's have a look at something else. We've got */*.php here. Basically means it'll go one directory deep, doesn't matter what it's called, and then look for any file ending with PHP. So as you can see right now, it's matching example.php in my QA basics directory. Now let's add another star and see what happens. Two stars actually means it can go an X amount of directories deep, it doesn't really matter. So it's pretty much matching everything. It can also be a zero, so my example.php in my root directory is also matched. So this is good to know. So let's look at pattern sets. A pattern set is basically a collection of those patterns. And why would you do that? Well, basically, you can have multiple file sets refer to multiple pattern sets. So if you feel the need to do this, you can actually create a pattern set that will match all PHP files. Create a pattern set that matches all XML files, and then eventually you can create your zip files file set referring to those two pattern sets. So again, don't repeat yourself. So it looks very similar to the file set. I open my pattern set tag, I give it an ID, in this case php.patternset, and I have two includes in there. And these includes are actually based upon our skeleton application. So you'll see that we have our source directory and our view. Underneath that, you see a file set. The file set, again, has an ID. It has a directory. And in there, I reference my pattern set that I previously defined. So is this clear to everyone? All right, excellent. You will notice I won't be using pattern sets in this talk, in this example, primarily because it won't fit on the slide. And it's just not very useful in my situation because there is no needs. I'm not going to be repeating this. I keep aiming at the screen. It's not actually going to do anything. All right, so let's put this together. So we've learned about properties, file sets, pattern sets, and in a little bit, we'll learn about tasks. So remember our first build.xml. It had just the project tag and the target build. Now we've added our properties to it, which is exactly the same as I showed you, together with the file set. So this is a great bootstrap to begin with. You have everything set up. You defined your directory structure, and you defined your PHP files. So let's move on to tasks. First, executing it's not going to do anything because there's still no logic in it. So I want to tell you a little bit about how we use Phing at the Webman. We're currently developing a lot of Magento modules. So what we want to do is we want to make sure that we want to execute quality assurance because we're going to be distributing these modules, so we want to make sure that they're of high quality. So that's what we use Phing for, and we use it in combination with continuous integration. Now this can be pretty much anything. In this case, we're using Jenkins, but there are many others out there that will also work. If you want to use Travis with Phing, you're going to have to include some bash scripts, but if you need that, just contact me and I can give it to you. So, quality assurance. Is there anyone here that hasn't heard of quality assurance? Which is okay, by the way. There's no, don't feel bad. You're taking a picture. Yeah. Ah, too late. So yeah, quality assurance is basically keeping your code quality high and your overall project of high quality. And we'll look into a couple of tools. First, I'm going to drink something because my mouth is like a desert. So I'm going to cover a couple of them. As you may know, there are a S-word ton of quality assurance tools. Four of those are PHPLint, PHP Mess Detector, Code Sniffer, and Units, PHPUnit. So we're going to be executing all of those quality assurance tools based on this example. Now, don't start screaming yet. I know this is horrible code, and I know you see the error probably already, but let's just see what our tools will do. So let's start with PHPLint. PHPLint is great. It's built into your PHP executable, and it's very easy to execute. And it's also relatively quick if you do some caching on the side. And simply set it checks for syntax errors. It does more than just that, but in this case, it'll find something interesting. So executing this is basically done by a PHP minus L, which will trigger the PHPLint, and we give it our file. So doing this on our code basically give this error, which I'm pretty sure most of you have already spotted. It says unexpected class expecting namespace separator or a semicolon or bracket. And if we look at our example.php, we can see that, yes, I have been stupid enough to miss my semicolon. So it's a great tool, and it's pretty much, yeah, I can see you nodding. I know it's bad. You can pretty much set this up as a pre-commit hook, which is great, and it prevents so many errors. So let's have a look at PHP Mess Detector. So you can install PHP Mess Detector through Git Composer as a peer package. And it detects code smells. I've tried to figure out what exactly it all detects, but it's quite a list of things, and some of them are quite complex. Simply said, it detects possible bugs, suboptimal code, and complicated expressions. When you have a function that has a million routes, it'll say, "Wow, this is too much." So let's have a look and see what this does to our code. You can execute this by doing PHPMD. You give it your file name. You give it what kind of output it should give. In this case, I use text, but you can also use HTML and I think Clover or something like that, or XML. And you tell it what to check for. And in case you're wondering, these are actually all the checks it has. So yeah, it looks bad. It's not that bad though. It's actually telling me that my variable names are too short, which I'd argue they're all right, you know. But as you can see, you can actually configure their minimum length. But it also says avoid unused parameters such as Z. So let's have a look at what this actually is. You can see my function there, the sum function, and it accepts x, y, and z. Now those are short short parameters, variables, but I'd argue they're still okay. But as you can also see, it says avoid unused variable C. You can see that I'm not actually using a variable, which is actually, you know, a bug. We've already detected a bug using PHP Mass Detector. So it's a very good tool to check on how clean your code actually is. PHP Code Sniffer. I like this one. Installation goes through Git Composer as a peer package, and it detects coding standards. It can check for coding standards. I think most popular here is PSR. I think everyone here has heard of PSR or uses it every day. But it can also detect Squiz and Zend and Pear.
What's Squiz?
Yeah, exactly. Squiz is actually the maker of PHP Code Sniffer. I've heard it's pretty bad, and you don't really want to look into it. So I'd say just stick with PSR.
Also, the Zen format doesn't match Zen.
Oh, it doesn't?
It has nothing to do with that.
That's very,
no one knows how I got there.
Very special. Let's just call that special. So executing a PHPCS, you give it the standard which you want to check for, and you give it your file. So let's see what this does to our code. Now you can see it detected about 4 errors. It says opening brace of a class must be online after definition, visibility must be declared, closing brace, blah 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 blah. Okay, it's pretty strict, but I like it. So if you look at this, I have class example and I have my bracket on the same line, which is so wrong. I have my function without a visibility. I should have put public there or protected or whatever, or public static, I don't know. Yeah, I have a closing tag in there, which is actually very, very bad. Don't ever do that.
As long as you don't have tabs, then you're
cool. You'll cry yourself to sleep one day. So let's have a look at the more interesting one, which is PHPUnit. Is there anyone here who hasn't heard of PHPUnit? Something tells me people are lying here, but yeah, it's okay. There you go. See, I knew it. So installation is similar as the previous ones, except for one. And you can install it. Well, yeah, you can install it as a PHP archive, Composer as a peer package. Actually, the peer package from 4.1 is actually just a PHP archive, so it's not really a peer package anymore. Don't bother. Phing is currently only compatible with 3.7 and below, so don't try 4.0, because you're not going to be happy. And basically, PHPUnit provides a framework to create your tests in, so let's create our own test. So this is a very simple test, and it's not going to scale very well when you have a lot of tests, but you can see we have our class example tests that extends the PHPUnit framework test case. And we have our test sum function. And basically, we're going to check if 2 plus 3 plus 1 equals 10, which I have a feeling it's not going to work. But let's execute this. You can see it failed. It says failed asserting that 5 matches expected 10. Now, I wonder why that happens. So let's have a look at our example at PHP. You can see our unused C variable. So that's PHPUnit in a nutshell there. So let's talk about Phing tasks. So Phing tasks are basically the core of Phing. I mean, it's what makes Phing powerful. There are a lot of tasks out there, and with a lot, I am not even joking. So let's go through a couple of these. So these are the core tasks. We have our copy task, which is just copying a file. Move, try catch. You can even define your try catch in your Phing build file. There are a lot of them, and don't use every single one of them, because that's just bad. Use them when you feel like you need to use them. There are some optional tasks. In this case, it's FTP tasks, Git tasks. There's a mail task in case you want to send yourself an email every time a build succeeds, although that would get pretty hectic at some point. We got subversion tasks, which is great for those who use subversion.
Which is not great.
Which is not great, exactly. Symfony console, actually, for those who are interested. Some more. So let's automate what we just learned with our quality assurance. So there's a task for PHPLint. That's very simple. As you can see, we first define our target, which is our PHPLint target. inside our targets, we can have a collection of tasks that do anything. In this case, I'm executing PHPLint. I'm also telling it to halt on failure, because PHPLint, if that detects something, that's bad. Like that's bad. You just stop right there. So halt on failure will basically cause the build to fail. Also, I'm giving it a cache file. And what this does is, imagine PHPLint having to go through your entire repository every time you make a build. It's going to slow you down. What a cache file does, it basically stores the modify time of your files, and only when a file is changed, it'll check it. So that's a huge speed improvement right there. And as you can see, we give a file set to our PHPLint task. And as you can see, I use the ref ID, and I'm referring to the file set that we defined previously. So don't repeat yourself. Use this. Moving on to our code snipper task. It's pretty similar. We have our targets, PHPCS. I like to divide all of my quality assurance tools over different tasks, so I can execute them specifically if I need to. So we call PHP code sniffer. We tell it which standard to use. By the way, you can also define your own standard. That's actually very useful, definitely when you work with Magento, because do not run PSR2 over Magento. It's just going to cry. So I have had to define my own task to actually make it succeed. Magento 2, I can't wait. And again, we give it our file set, which is our PHP files file set. Also, in this case, we can give it a formatter. PHP code sniffer, a lot of people like to a lot of people like statistics, and they're actually very useful. So I was at in Antwerp, PHP Benelux, and I had the workshop from Keith Casey, and he was talking about Jenkins, and of course also a little bit of Phing. And he actually said something very interesting to me, at least. I didn't realize this, but it's important not as much to look at what code sniffer is going to tell you, but it's important to look at whether that's going to peak or not. Because if that peaks, then you know something's wrong. Someone committed some horrible code, and you need to look at it. So it's not always important to have your complete projects completely according to the standard. So you can give it a formatter, and with this, you can actually create easy statistics within Jenkins. So that's a great way of doing it. So our PHP message detector task is actually very simple, and I don't think I need to explain very much. Again, we have our targets, PHPMD, and our file set does the same thing. Now, I wish I could say that, I mean, there is a PHPUnit test, don't get me wrong. Don't use it. Please don't. I tried using it. I tried really, really hard, probably a couple hours, with no success. It works in simple cases, but once you want to start using your existing PHPUnit.xml configuration, it's not going to work. So I would recommend either fixing up the task or just using our exec task, which is basically executing a command on your system. So in this case, we're going to have a target PHPUnit, and we have two exec tasks because we have two modules, and they both have their tests. And you simply give in the commands it has to execute, so PHPUnit minus C, which is your configuration, and a pass-through will actually make the output of this command come through in your Phing output. So that's great. And you can check the return, so the exit code. If it exits with code 1 or anything aside from 0, it'll actually fail the build. So this is still fully functional as you would have in a normal PHPUnit task. But I recommend using this because it's going to save you a lot of headaches. All right. So let's expand our existing build.xml file. It looks like a lot. It's not that much. We've got our properties, which we defined earlier. And we've got our target name build, which we also defined earlier. And I've gone ahead and added everything that we just discussed into this build file. So that's great. Awesome. Let's do it. Oh, shit. OK, it's not actually going to do anything, simply because our build target is still empty. It doesn't do anything. Luckily, we have an easy solution. You can make a target depend on other targets. in this case, we're going to make our build target depend on the targets that we just created. So that's PHPLint, PHPCS, PHPMD, and PHPUnit. So it's gonna execute these, and only once. So if you somehow already executed PHPLint, it's not going to do it again. I mean, that would be useless. So let's try and execute it now, and you'll see that we're going to get an error. This error is quite simple because it says unable to open var www zf2 build cache lint.cache. This is the cache file that we defined previously in our, and quickly go back to this, in our PHP lint task. You can see there we give it a cache file, but it can't create it. This is because the directory doesn't exist. A good solution for this is creating another target. More targets, awesome. So we can create a prepare target. And what we put in this prepare target is basically everything we need to get our environment set up. So in this case, I'm going to create all my directories. So I'm going to create my build directory, I'm going to create my cache directory, my logs directory, everything. And we're going to add this to, all right. There's a little trick. I learned this from Stefan. He also does a Phing talk. And if you give it a name with a dash in front of it, it's not going to be able to execute it directly. So this is a way to make your prepared target unexecutable from the command line, because it doesn't do anything by itself. It's useless. So with a dash in front of it, you can't execute it, because the Phing executable will think it's an argument or a flag. And you know, it's like, well, what is this? So. And with giving the hidden attribute true, it doesn't appear when we do PHP minus L. So thank you, Stefan, for that. You might as well just do the talk right now. It doesn't really matter. So what we're going to do now is we're going to make sure that every target depends on that prepare target to make sure that our directories are there. And when we execute this again, it'll actually do something. Hooray. We've got our first actual Phing build going on. So it tells you which targets it's executing. It's starting off with prepare, then phplint, which didn't result in anything, so that's good. phpcs, which of course is going to whine about stuff. In this case, it's that my line exceeded the characters. And it's going to execute phpmd. It's processing some files. It's kind of cool to see that the that framework 2 tutorial is not compatible or is not fully optimized. But yeah, it still finds bugs. Or, well, bugs, I mean code smells. And it's going to execute phpUnit, in which you see this is actually the same output you get as you would execute the phpUnit executable by yourself. So in the end, it says build finished. Nothing happened, nothing bad happened. It executed all the tests and they all passed, so yay, we're happy. Yeah, because we have two modules. We have our album module and our application module. So let's move on to some logical tasks. There is an if task, there is a condition task, a fill task, and a for each task. Now these might not seem very useful in the beginning. I'm gonna try and convince you that there are use cases for them. So let's look at the if task real quick. I'm pretty sure we're all familiar with the PHP if statement, so it's pretty much the same. We define a property, we name it foo, and it has a value bar. Very original, I know, thank you. We execute our if task, and we give it the condition saying equals argument 1, argument 2. So if those two equal, then we've got a success if statement. So we say if equals, then echo, else echo. So I think this is pretty clear to everyone, am I right? Yes, okay, awesome. So let's move on to our condition task, which is going to be fun. So we have our condition task, and we tell it which property to put to actually fill this, which property to set if the condition is true. So in this case, I'm checking if Phing is a recursive acronym. Phing stands for Phing is not GNU make, and Phing is in the full word Phing is not GNU make, so it is a recursive acronym. It's very interesting. I don't know why they did that. Well, PHP isn't though. Because yeah, okay.
Yeah, well,
originally it was personal homepage or something.
Personal homepages was dropped very early on.
Yeah, okay. But yeah, okay, PHP is also a recursive acronym. So yeah, we're going to check if the string thing is not gene you make contains the word thing, and we're going to make sure that it's not checking for any case-sensitive stuff because, yeah, that's not very useful in this case. So we have our if task saying is true, value is thing recursive acronym. Then echo it's recursive, else echo it's not recursive. So what do you guys think this is going to echo? You're a genius, I swear to God. Would you like a job? No, I was kidding. So yeah, it echoes it's recursive. So let's move on to our other condition. So here we're going to check if XML is a recursive acronym. Now, it's not. I'll tell you this beforehand. XML stands for Extensible Markup Language. And we're going to check if the substring XML exists in this, and we're going to turn case sensitivity off. So we're going to execute an if task. We're going to say if is true, is XML recursive acronym, echo, it's recursive, else it's not recursive. So what do you guys think is going to happen here?
It's going to blow up.
It's going to blow up.
Yeah,
well,
it's XML.
Oh, right. Got some pretty serious issues there. So yeah, what is this going to echo? It's not recursive. OK. Well, I'm not hiring you guys. That was horrible. This is actually going to echo it's recursive. I'm challenging you to figure out why. And I may or may not have put you on the wrong foot. Huh? Case sensitivity. Case sensitivity is sent to false, so that seems fine to me, actually.
It's a set instead of a literal. It means to match every one of those characters, maybe?
No, not necessarily. Come on, get creative.
It's checking the public name.
Oh. So, can you explain a little bit further what's happening?
No, it was a wild guess.
Oh, it was a wild guess. All right. That's great. Yeah. Well. Okay. So I'm just gonna tell you. so I did put you on the wrong foot there. So what condition does? It sets the property when the condition is true, and I said this earlier. So when this is not true, the property is not going to be set, and what happens? Is XML recursive acronym, well, let's go back actually, this value I'm giving it, that property doesn't exist. So what's going to happen, it's going to evaluate if the string dollar bracket is XML recursive acronym bracket is true, which, you know, PHP being, it's true. So I'm sorry, that was a bit mean of me. But
so you're violating the whole type handling?
I'm violating everything right
XML
now.
XML to PHP.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah.
You're reporting bad typing to XML.
Exactly.
Right?
You know, I thought it was a good plan.
But, yeah.
So yeah, this is. It's just gonna check if that string is true. It's pretty bad. I actually think it should. It should just throw something, or it should just echo nothing, or something.
It should just kill you.
that seems a bit violent, but perhaps. So that's why instead we're gonna use the isSet. And isSet is actually gonna, as you can see, I'm not giving the dollar bracket blah blah. I'm just gonna tell the property name, and it's gonna check if it's set. And in this case, it's gonna say it's not recursive.
But
so
those conditions, are they ever not hard coded? Why would your elf have an if?
There, you'll find out later that not everything is hard coded in the Phing build file. I'll show you that later. Okay. So let's move on to our fill task. A fill task can be useful in case you want to make sure your build fails when an if statement fails, for example. So a fill task is pretty straightforward. You tell it the message to say, like failed for whatever reason. And you can also say fail if the error property exists, or fail unless that property exists. So we'll use this a little later. Is everyone still getting this, or am I going too fast?
No.
Excellent. All right. Our for each task. It seems very, how do I say this, overly complicated. It is, actually. It's overly complex. So we have our file set, fruits. I don't know what went through my mind when I was making this, but basically it looks for files that is either in a directory fruits that has the extension XML or is a PHP file. It doesn't make any sense, but that's okay. And we have our build target. And inside the build target, we're gonna be executing our for each. So there are two ways of executing a for each. You can execute a for each using a file set, or you can execute a for each using a delimited list. The first one is a file set. So you tell it to for each, and then you tell it which parameter, and a parameter is gonna be the property it's gonna fill with the value of that iteration. I hope you're getting this. So for each parameter fruits, execute target display fruit. So for every iteration, so for every file, it's gonna call the target display fruit and it's gonna set the fruit property to the value. And on the bottom, you see a target name display fruit, and that is where we echo our fruit. Yay. That is so complex. It's probably gonna fill up your entire build file if your build file is full with this. But you can also for each through a list that is delimited by a semicolon. So let's look at some interesting tasks here. The property prompt task I actually really like, and we're also going to look at the PHP evil with an I task. So the property prompt task is cool because it brings some interaction to your Phing build. So property prompt will actually ask you, in this case it's going to ask me, please enter your name. And you can fill in your name, whatever it is, foobar. I don't know if there's anyone called foobar. And you can also give it a default value, which if you just press enter, that'll be your value. And you tell it which property name to fill. Now underneath that, I have my property messages.welcome, in which I say hello, comma, the property. So executing our build targets will echo the Phing project name, which is the name you see there on the top example, together with my welcome message. So let's try this. So I execute Phing. It asks me, please enter your name, Rick, in my case. It's gonna execute the target build file, and it says, hello, Rick. Awesome, we just got some interactivity into our build, which is actually gonna be quite useful, and I'll show you why. So let's have a look at the PHP evil task, but let's not look at it for too long. PHP eval task is basically a way to use PHP in your build file. And you're laughing, but that's actually hilarious because why? So yes, we've got our target build. I don't even know why I'm explaining this. I've got something way worse to show you. We're going to execute the PHP eval task. Don't ask me why. And I'm going to define a function, which is increment I. And I'm going to return it with plus 1. Then I'm going to execute the function. And that result of the function is going to fill my return property. And then I can echo my return property. So this is what it looks like. And the horrible thing is it actually tells you every time you execute the PHP eval task. I cannot get rid of these messages saying, calling function, evaluating PHP expression is horrible.
Well, everybody should know that you're
yeah, oh. It's just to shame me, yeah, okay.
So you can't get rid of those, so you actually use this.
Maybe, I don't know. I'm gonna leave that in the middle, okay? So.
Grab your pitchfork, man.
So it's gonna echo two. Now, I've done something way worse. And I thought,
what?
So we can execute PHP inside our build file. So that means we can move all of our tests from our PHP unit inside our build file, which is amazing, right?
Yeah.
Yes. So I spend way too long on this to create a Phing unit testing framework. Yes, I can see you hitting yourself. I was doing the same, pretty much. I think I drank something weird. But basically, you have, underneath you see our target name test. It has an if statement, or an if task. I check if my result is equal to my expected property, and if so, it echoes a little check. If not, it echoes an X and it fails the build. Our build targets will execute a PHP function, which can be anything. You could basically create your all object, fill the object, create a mock or something. I don't know what you're gonna do. And exactly. We have our property name expected, which we're gonna say, okay, so I'm expecting Phing. And you can see our return property's result, which is our result. So we call the Phing Phing target called test, and it's gonna test it. The same with the second one. So it actually works. I'm ashamed. So you can see our first test passes, and our second test, it doesn't pass because I fucked up something in my regular expression.
Well, it's very clear why it failed.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's what I mean. I mean, why not use it?
No, man, it's easy. If you get this to read input from, like, get parameters, you got a virus.
Exactly. It's excellent. Great backdoor. Now to a more serious subject. Here is our PHP unit target. Now, let's use everything that we've learned in the previous slides, except for the unit testing thing, and use that to our advantage. So I'm actually going to use the property prompt here, our if task, for each. And why am I using PHP eval? Oh, right, yeah, OK. So PHP eval can be useful sometimes, I'm ashamed to say. So let's look at this. We have our target PHP units. It's going to execute property prompt. It's going to ask you which module would you like to run a test for. Because remember, we have two modules. We have our application module and our album module. So if we want to make this a little bit more easy to use, and if we want to make Phing a single point of entry, we're going to be asking the user executing Phing, what module would you like to test? And as you can see, as default value, I've set all. So I also give him the option to test all of the modules. So it's going to ask us which module. Then we're going to do an if statement saying, all right, does the module equal all? If so, we're going to execute all of our all the unit tests in all of our modules. So I'm going to call the targets run all tests. And if we look at run all tests, it does something which I'm going to explain later. We also have our else, which is going to set the property. You know what? I'm actually first going to go to the run all tests. So in a run all test target, the point is to run all the tests of every module. But it's a little more tricky than you think it is, because we don't actually know beforehand which modules we have. So we first got to figure that out. So we're going to use a for each task. And we're going to give that for each task a file set, which is our source directory in which our modules are. And we're going to look for every PHP unit XML file. And for every file that we find, we're gonna be executing our target run test. And run test is gonna execute the PHP function dir name to actually get the directory, because you can't tell PHP unit to use a configuration if you give it the exact file. You gotta give it the folder. So we use dir name to get the folder, and then we call phpUnit to execute the configuration inside that folder. So this is basically a great way to make Phing your single point of entry and make sure that that people can do everything with Phing, and they can say which model you want to run the test for. So I don't have an example for that. That's a shame. Well, it works. what time? Am I going too fast?
No, you're going exactly right.
Well, that's not giving me any useful information here. does this reflect the time that I still have?
Are you going to say eval one more time?
No.
Okay, then you can carry it.
Actually, I am.
Oh, time's over. All
right, so let's go on and create our own task. Like I said, Phing is built in PHP, so Phing is very easy to extend. So has anyone ever heard of VDD? No, not VND, VDD. Nobody, are you kidding me? It's not really a real term though, so.
You made it up, right?
No, you know it. I'm pretty sure you know it. Almost. You're getting there. It's actually fardom driven development. I think I think we're all guilty of this. Well, I was almost going to say guilty of this pleasure. It's not really a pleasure, though. So yeah, when I debug my application, I use fardoms. I still sometimes do, maybe not. So it's actually better to use a remote debugger. In this case, you can use Xdebug or PHP DBG, which is built into PHP 5.6, if I'm not mistaken. So you should look into that. So let's create a solution for this fard-driven development virus. We've got Phing, so we've got this nice framework to work with. So let's create our own task. The task is going to be called fardom task. It's going to do a few things. In this case, it's going to accept a file set. It's going to find lines for every file in that file set that contains the word fardump. It's going to ignore those that have // in front of it. I'm not going to do the multi-line comments because that's too complicated. So it's going to ignore everything that has // in front of it. And it's going to show the files and the line numbers that match. And it's going to have an option to actually halt on match. So let's do this. This is basically what a very naked and bare task would look like. We require our task, which is what we're going to be extending. And we have our main function, which is where all the main logic is going to go into, hence the name main.
Is that not namespaced?
Your question was, is that not namespaced? Phing is actually not namespaced at all. They're trying to improve the project, but I don't know how quick that's going to go. I hope soon. Call Michiel. We're going to have our public function main, which is where all our main stuff is going to go. So another include, for a file set. Our first requirement was for it to accept a file set. Everything that you put inside a task is going to call a creator on that task. So if we put a file set tag into our task, it's actually going to call this function that says create file set. Now what we do in this function is we create the file set, we add it to our array of file sets, and we return it for Phing to fill up the file set. Now we also want to check to make sure that we have a file set, else we can't really do much. So we throw a build exception, which is actually going to fill. Any exception is going to fill the build file, the build. But I guess the build exception will be most appropriate. So let's, it doesn't really fit on the slide, but let's add in some main logic here. So we've got our file sets, and we're going to loop through every single file set that we have, and for every file inside that file set. We're going to get the full file name. And we're going to execute a function which we'll later look at called grep. And it's not really stolen from Ubuntu or anything. We're going to give it which file we want to grep. We're going to, I don't know why I made that a constant, but it's a constant. Get on with it. Fardump. And we're going to tell it the third argument is what lines it should ignore. In this case, the lines with //. For everything that we find, we're going to log it. And logging, this log basically shows it in the Phing output. So let's look at our grep function. It might be bad. It's not very efficient, I know that. But in this case, we're just going to use it because I said so. So we're going to loop through every line in the file. We're going to check if the value fardump exists in it. By the way, it's much more efficient to use grep if you're running Ubuntu or whatever anyway. But in this case, I want to make it cross-system, cross-OS. And we're going to check if there's a // in front of it. If not, then we're going to return the line number. Now, next, what we want to do is we want to implement our halt on match logic. So a setter is called every time you have the attribute inside your task. So if I have my task VDD and I have an attribute saying halt and match, and that has the value true, it's going to call this setter. And so basically, I'm going to be storing this in my halt and match variable. So we're going to extend our logic a bit more, and we're actually going to check. We're going to have our a found variable, set it to false initially, loop through everything. If we find something, we set it to true. And if we found something and halt and match is set to true, we're going to throw a build exception saying, this is not right, I found something. So let's define this task. We have two options. We have the ad hoc task dev task and the task dev task. So there's a task to define your task. I mean, why wouldn't there be? So yeah, speaking of eval. I asked, the lead developer is Michiel Rook, and I asked him why this is still in there, and he says people apparently still use it. not me. So yeah, let's just not look at this. So we have our task dev task, which is a lot better. You can just say, you can give the task a name, which in this case it's VDD, and we can give it a class name. It looks a bit strange, but what it actually does is it looks in the Phing directory, in the task directory, and in the file fardump task.php. Yes, it is almost like namespaces.
And then evals it.
So we define our task. We create a new target called VDD. It depends on our prepare. Remember, we gotta make sure that everything depends on prepare. And we're gonna execute the VDD task with our halt and match true, and we give it a file set. So executing this, and actually put a far dump in my code to test this. So it executes the VDD target, and it says, you know, I found something. I found traces of far dump, and it actually tells me which file and which line number. And this is great because in PHP Storm, it'll actually underline this, and you can just click on it. It'll go straight to the right. I'm not sure if it goes to the same to the right line number, but it goes to the right file, so that's good. Pizza? Pizza. Pizza's almost here, so let's wrap this up. So let's have a look at our complete build file. Remember when we went from just our project tag and our target build, we're going to look at what we have now. So we have our file set. We have our target name build, which depends on every task, and I added VDD to it. We have our prepare target, which is creating all the directories to make sure our environment is set up. We have our PHPLint. The indenting doesn't really work, but that's indented, like one tap. So we have our PHPLint target, which depends on prepare. We have our PHPCS target, which depends on prepare. Our PHPMD target, which depends on prepare. And our VDD target, which depends on prepare. Our PHPUnit target, which also depends on prepare. And this is the one where you can choose which module to execute. So I want to tackle one complication that you might find. So imagine you have 100 projects, and they're all kind of similar. Some of them have some differences in it. It'd be pretty bad to have 100 build files laying around with logic and all duplicated stuff. You don't want to do that. So there is a solution to that. Build file inheritance. This is great, and I'll show you why in a bit. And Git submodules. So instead of having a build file, well, we're going to have a build file for every project, but instead of having all of the logic in that build file, we're going to define a default build file. The default file, in it by itself, if you execute it, it's not going to do anything, but it has all the tasks in there, or all the targets, I should say. So it has our VDD, it has our PHPLint, et cetera, et cetera. Now, in your actual build file, all you have to do is you import the file, and it will import all of that logic, and you can just create your build target, and you can just say, it depends on PHPLint, PHPCS, et cetera, et cetera, and it'll actually use the logic that's defined in the default XML. Now, put this into a Git submodule, and you've actually got a great way to prevent duplicating your build file logic. So a slight note on documentation here. I like the documentation. It's pretty good. You can find it at phing.info/doc/guide/table, or just Google like everyone else does. And the GitHub is phingofficial/phing. I think it still needs quite a few contributors. I think it's a great project, and I really enjoy using it. So that's it. If there are any questions, feel free to ask them. Yeah?
Do you use
property files?
Property files?
Yeah. The question was, what about property files? You can use property files. I didn't cover it in this talk, but Phing can use property files. And the idea is you can also do deployments with Phing. It's out of the scope of this talk, but you can do it. And if you look at Michiel Roek's talk, he talks about deployments, and it's quite interesting. The idea is to have properties files spread across your different environments, so your development, your staging, and your production. And those property files have different properties where the build file logic will act differently. So that's also because our PHPUnit target is now interactive. That wouldn't really work when you're deploying or when you're integrating with Jenkins, because you know Jenkins, it shouldn't have interaction. So one way of solving that is by having a build.properties and importing that and checking if a property exists to make sure that you don't ask any questions, because Jenkins doesn't know how to. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, I was just wondering if this could work.
Yeah, that's definitely good. Yeah, excellent. Any other questions?
Does Phing have the equivalent of and have like a parallel task where it can run multiple things in parallel?
Yes, it does.
It's gonna take a while.
Hold on, I'm gonna answer your question. Hold on, I got this.
With the long list, go, go, go.
Ah, button bashing. Oh, there it is. There it is. No eval. So yes, you do have a parallel task. I've never used it, but I'm guessing it's equivalent to the end parallel task. So I hope that answers your question. Pizza. Okay. Yes.
So thanks for the talk, by the way.
You're welcome. Very compatible, actually. It should only I'll repeat the question. His question was, how compatible is the Phing build XML with an Ant build XML? And it's actually very, very compatible. And it should only take you a few minutes to actually convert little things to make it work. So I hope that answers your question. If you look at the documentation, like I said, they're almost the same. So there's really not much difference in there. I wouldn't know, actually.
Well, the other one is Java.
Yeah.
You
only have something up and running in Ant. Why would I bother changing?
Because it's PHP.
No, I'm not going to be writing PHP.
No, okay, you're not going to be writing inside it. But or you might. We don't know. I'm not going to judge. But the great thing about Phing is that you can extend it. And I've had Java, but I'm not a Java programmer, and with Phing, I'm comfortable. First of all, I can read the source code. Second of all, if there's a bug, I could probably debug it, except for the PHPUnit task. That thing is ripped. Third or fourth, I don't know where I went, you can create your own tasks, like I just showed you, which is, you can also do that in Ant, undoubtedly, but it's going to be more difficult because it's Java, and you're not comfortable with Java. Well, I'm not comfortable with Java. So
I think the first thing is it's one less.
Exactly, it's also one less dependency.
You already have Java going around, you don't want to put that in.
Exactly. This is you have PHP, assumingly, so this should be fine.
Also, there are a lot of PHP-related tasks already to be defined.
That's also true. There are a lot of tasks PHP-related. Any other questions?
So, on that topic, I'm not sure if this is good or not, but I saw it coming by this week. Someone launched something called builder.io. Equivalent of Gulp.
Grunt. All right.
Grunt and Gulp are the same thing.
No.
No. Oh, my friend. No.
They both run tasks?
Right? Yeah.
We'll have this discussion. No, but still, like, how is that any different from
this?
Yeah.
It's practicing. It's a task runner.
So what's the question?
Yeah. Do you have anything useful to say?
Why, yeah.
why and when did you see it?
I didn't see it actually. What is it? BLDER. I'm gonna check it out.
Builder with help.
Okay.
I
haven't seen it, but. Ecosystem or ecosystem?
Both.
Both, all right.
So it has a large eval system.
I think I should have put a meme here saying eval all the things, but yeah, that should be appropriate. Assuming that was the last question, I thank you all for coming out. This is actually my first time here at AmsterdamPHP, and I don't know a lot of you, so please come talk to me. I'm very lonely.
Best of you, eval.